Today's class is about timers in LPC 2148. The last class we discussed how to use PLL of LPC 2148. PLL is primarily used to boost the incoming clock frequency. So we also saw the chain of LPC 2 clocking chain of LPC 2148. So here is our microcontroller. So we have the external oscillator. All of you, please mute yourself at the receiving end. Google Meet is giving very little options for the host here, so I cannot mute all of you. So all of you, please mute your audio at the other side. Otherwise, this classroom will become a noisy one. So this is my oscillator. So the oscillator gives me a 12 megahertz output. This is then going to our PLL. This PLL gives me a CPU clock or C clock at 60 megahertz. We then divide this by a VLSI peripheral bus divider and divide this fellow by a suitable factor. So though we had different choices, we derived P clock from this. We still derived 60 megahertz by putting this divider as a 1. So both our CPU clock as well as our peripheral clock, P clock, CLK, or 60 megahertz. This is then divided by a register called prescalar register, PR. PR stands for prescalar register. The prescalar register divides this 60 megahertz clock a suitable factor. This is a 32-bit register. You can divide this 60 megahertz into any desirable clock. This is actually going to your timer. In LPC 2148, we call this as timer counter, TC. In LPC 2148, we call the timer as timer counter because it does both the jobs of timing as well as counting. In 8051, we call that as timer 0 or timer 1. We call this as timer counter. This is more appropriate because the word timer is slightly misleading. Timer counter is the appropriate word because it is essentially a counter which is used for timing applications. So in LPC 2148, we call this as timer counter, TC. So 8051 versus LPC 2148. If you see the time difference, if you see the scheme difference, in 8051 you have the oscillator, you have the crystal, the oscillator inside. This oscillator generates your clock output, which is then divided by a fixed prescalar divided by 12. Which is then going to your timer 0 or timer 1. This is my 8051 scheme. In LPC 2148, we have the oscillator. The oscillator is supplied by a PLL. PLL converts this oscillator frequency, which is coming at 12 megahertz. To 60, which is then divided by a variable prescalar. This is the difference between 8051 and LPC 2148. Prescaling, the word prescaling means dividing the incoming clock to a suitable factor. We divided this oscillator frequency, F oscillator, by a suitable frequency here, F oscillator by 12. It is always a fixed value. In this case, this is a 32-bit register, which means you have literally any possible combinations in which you can divide this particular clock that is actually going to a timer counter. Essentially, the chain of LPC2148 is given here. Here is my oscillator, which is having my crystal connected across the crystal pins. So this is essentially a 12 megahertz crystal. So the oscillator, which is present inside your microcontroller, all these things are present inside your microcontroller. So this fellow gives you a clock output of 12 megahertz, followed by a PLL. We have M select and P select. We configure them in such a way that we end up in getting a 60 megahertz C clock. From that, we use VLSI peripheral bus divider and we take a peripheral clock. In this case, both P clock is equal to CPU clock. Both of them are operating at 60 megahertz. This is then divided by a prescalar register, and then the divided value is then given to the timer counter. So this is the configuration. Plus one is represented here just because whatever the value that you load into prescalar register, the processor will add one to it just to prevent divide by zero error. So what it means, whatever you load into prescalar register, the processor will add a value of one to it. Suppose if you load prescalar is equal to 100, the processor will add one to it and the total value becomes 101. If you want the total value itself to be 100, then you have to load prescalar register with 99 and the processor will add one to it so that the total value becomes 100. So you understand the concept. So whatever the value that you load into this particular thing, the processor will add a one to it. So that is something that you have to keep in mind. So what are the important SFRs that you have to keep in mind? First one, count control register, CTCR, important SFRs. First one is count control register, CTCR. CTCR stands for count control register. Okay, so this is equivalent to T mode of 8051, which is used to set the mode. Just for remembrance. The first two bits are of important for us. Though this is a 32-bit register, the first two bits, LSB, and the bit number one, bit zero and bit one. So these four bits will give you four possible combinations, 00, 01, 10, and 11. 00 means this is used as a timer. For the rest of the three conditions, it is used as a counter, event counter. What is event counter means? The microcontroller will take external pulses and depending upon whether it is rising edge or falling edge, the counter will increment its value by one. If it is configured as timer, then it takes the internal clock from the crystal oscillator. So the oscillator will supply the clock for 00. For the rest of the three combinations, it will get the input from the external pin. So depending upon whether you are configuring the timer as timer or counter. So what is the three combinations here? 01 corresponds to when the external pulse is undergoing a transition, the microcontroller will make an increment. But if it is configured as 01, then the microcontroller is sensitive for low to high going edge, a rising edge. If you configure this as 1 to 10, the microcontroller is sensitive for 1 to 0 transition of the incoming signal. If you are setting 11, then the microcontroller will start counting for both the edges, both rising edge as well as falling edge. So these three conditions will tell you for which edge the microcontroller is sensitive for when the microcontroller is configured as a counter. If it is 00, then the microcontroller is configured as timer. So count control register is primarily tell you whether the timer is used as a timer or a counter. If it is set at 00, initial two bits are set to 00. In that case, we are configuring that as timer. If it is set to 01 or 10 or 11, we are configuring that as a counter. These three different settings will tell you what is the exact edge for which the counter is sensitive for. 01 means it is sensitive for rising edge. 10 means it is sensitive for falling edge. 11 means it is sensitive for both edge. That's what it means. So it is the very first SFR that we have to understand, count control register. Second one is the prescalar register. Prescalar register is the second register which is used to divide the PLL output with a suitable value, output clock with a suitable value. This will give you direct control over, so this is basically going to your timer counter. So there is a clock that is coming here. What is the frequency of this clock? You can always decide. In 8051, you don't have that choice because it is always F oscillator divided by 12. So this is the only figure that you can play with. You don't have much of a choice. Here, the denominator is a variable one. In this case, you can decide whatever the frequency that you wanted. Let us say, for example, example one, I want this timer counter to have a frequency of 1 kilohertz. So F is equal to 1 kilohertz. So that it increments every 1 millisecond. 1 kilohertz means what? The total time period, on period and off period. This total time period is equal to 1 millisecond. So every 1 millisecond, the timer will increment its value. So I always get the round values of the delays that I generate. Unlike in 8051 microcontroller, I really fed up with calculating the fractional values of delay. Here you get a very precise delays because it always gives you a round number. So for example, if I am interested in creating a delay for 100 milliseconds, if the clock is coming at 1 kilohertz, which means the time period equal to 1 millisecond. So if the timer counter counts for 100 counts, I end up in getting a delay of 100 milliseconds. It's as simple as that. So how to make the timer counter to have a frequency of 1 kilohertz is the next question. So this fellow P clock or the peripheral clock is coming at 60 megahertz. I have to divide this fellow by 1 kilohertz. So what is the value of prescalar plus 1? Prescalar plus 1 equal to 60 megahertz divided by 1 kilohertz. So this is my incoming, this is my outgoing. So I'd simply divide that. 60 is 60 into 10 raised to 6. 1 kilohertz is 1 into 10 raised to 3. So this goes here 3 times. This is 10 raised to 3. So 60 into 10 raised to 3 is 60,000. So prescalar plus 1 is 60,000. So what is the value that I should load into prescalar register? 60,000 minus of 1. So 59. I should not go to the extreme bottom. So it is 59,999. So this is the value that I load into prescalar. So if I load this fellow with 59,999, so that will divide the 60 megahertz into a suitable value. So I end up in getting 1 kilohertz on the other side. Let us now take, for example, a second situation where I wanted to divide example two. I put it here. So I want this frequency F is equal to 1 megahertz, let us say. 1 megahertz means the total time period is equal to, instead of 1 microsecond, I end up in getting 1 microsecond. So I can generate very precise delays, small, extremely small time delays, say 10 microsecond or 20 microsecond or something like that. So in that case, what will I do? Prescalar plus 1 equal to. So this value I have to divide. So incoming clock is 60 megahertz The required clock frequency, timer clock I wanted is 1 MHz. 60 MHz by 1 MHz is 60. So prescalar plus 1 equal to 60. And then what is my prescalar? Prescalar is equal to 59. So if I load this fellow with simply 59, then I end up getting a timer frequency of 1 MHz. So literally you can control what is the frequency of your timer by setting any value of prescalar. What is the significance of that? The significance of that is basically I can either make the timer clock at a high frequency or at a low frequency, depending upon what is my delay requirement. Thereby I can generate a delay program without much of a fuss. In fact, you don't have to put a loop, a for loop, for creating larger delays. It can generate delays for months or years together if you set the timer value accordingly, prescalar value accordingly. So there is no real requirement for creating a time delay for smaller delays and then loop it for achieving higher delays and all. If you want to do it, you can do it, but you have the provision for setting the prescalar value to practically any delay value that you are interested in. So that is the advantage. So instead of a fixed value of oscillator by 12, unlike in 8051, we have a variable prescalar control here. That is the biggest advantage that you have in LPC2148. It's a very beautiful option. All of you are with me so far? Next one, the first SFR we saw is the count control register, number one. The second one was the prescalar. Third one is the timer control register. This is equivalent to TCON. In 8051, this is just for your understanding. Don't confuse that with here. So timer control register is used to enable or disable a register, enable or disable a timer. So there are two bits here. The first one is the enable bit. The second one is the reset bit. So if you make enable equal to 1, the counter is enabled. Timer counter is enabled. If you make enable equal to 0, then the timer counter is disabled. This is something similar to your timer run control bit of 8051. So if you want the timer to run, you make this one to 1. If you don't want that to run, you put it to 0. Okay, so reset is a way of making the timer counter value to 0, TC equal to 0. So if you make a reset value as 1, then in that case, your timer counter will take a value of 0. We don't normally use this fellow because we directly put the timer counter with 0 value. We load the timer counter with 0 instead of using this reset pin and all. So we don't normally use that. So enable and disable we use frequently because we want to start or stop the timer. So this is only bit that you use. The timer control register TCR. So we saw three registers: count control register CTCR, prescalar register, and the timer control register. Finally, the actual timer itself TC. TC stands for timer counter. Timer counter is a 32-bit counter here. In 8051. We call this as timer 0 or timer 1. Timer 0 consists of two 8-bit components, TL0, TH0. T1 consists of TL1 and TH1. This is a 16-bit component. Here, this fellow has one single register, which is 32-bit in nature. So the minimum count is what? You know the count value, right? So minimum count is what? Minimum count is always 0 for any counter. Maximum count is what? 2 power of n minus of 1, where n is the length of the counter. So it is 2 power of 32 minus of 1. So what it means, you take your calculator, go to scientific. So what is 2 x to the power of 32. So this is what it is. 429 crores, 49 lakhs, 67,296 counts. 429 crores, 49 lakhs, 67,296. So let me copy this figure. 296. This is 2 power n. This is 2 power of n. 2 power of n minus of 1 is what? 429 crores, 49 lakhs, 67,295 counts. So 0 to 429, 49, 67, 295. In total, 429, 49, 67, 296 counts. So that is a total number of counts it can count. Let us take a small example. Assuming that this fellow is having a input coming at 1 kilohertz, let us say. F is equal to 1 kilohertz. You can also generate a higher clock frequency, but for time being, let us assume that F is equal to 1 kilohertz. F is equal to 1 kilohertz means time for 1 clock is 1 millisecond. So if the time period for 1 clock is 1 millisecond, what is the time for generating, what is the total delay this fellow can achieve from 0 to 429, 49, 67, 295, totally you will end up in getting 429, 49, 67, 296 counts. So total delay equal to, total delay is equal to 429, 49, 67, 296 multiplied by 1 millisecond. So you would end up in getting that many number of milliseconds. Yes or no? So you end up in getting 429, 49, 67, 296 milliseconds. How many seconds? Divide this by 1000. So it is 429, 49.67 seconds. How many hours? Divide this by 16. This is seconds. So let me take that calculator again. So 2x to the power of 32 equal to, so this is the total number of counts. For each count, if I end up in getting, if it takes 1 milliseconds for counting, so totally I'll end up in getting this many number of milliseconds. How many seconds? Divide this by 1000. So I end up in getting 429, 49, 67 seconds. How many hours? You divide this by 60. Now, how many minutes I'm asking, not hours. So it is 71,582 minutes. If you want to get hours, again, divide this by 60. That is 1,193 hours. You again divide this by 24. So it is getting 49.7 days, roughly 50 days. So which means when you take a clock of you take a, you know, prescaler and fix your timer frequency at 1 kilohertz, the timer counter, if you start, it roughly takes 50 days to overflow. That is advantage that you get in a 32-bit counter, which means I really don't think that you need a delay for 50 days. So the thing that I am trying to explain you here is you really don't have to loop for any larger delays. Even for days together, you can just run it in a single stroke. That is because of the sheer 32-bit nature of the timer that you are playing here. So setting up of your timer counter is pretty straightforward here. Whatever we used to discuss in our regular timer applications is still applicable here. Whatever you are going to discuss here is just similar to our routine timer counters. So first thing, what? configure your timer as timer. So put your count control register as 00. So configure this as timer first. Probably red color will give you more impact. Configure your timer counter as timer. Then you load the prescaler with a suitable value. And then start your timer. And then wait for your, the timer to reach a specific value. That's all. It's pretty straightforward. There is no fancy things here. How to initialize the timer? So for timer 0, you need to add T0 in front of all these registers. For timer 1, you need to put T1. For example, timer 0, count control register. Timer 0, prescaler register. Timer 0, timer control register. This is for timer 0. For timer 1, it is timer 1, count control register. Timer 1, prescaler register. Timer 1, timer control register. That's all. These are the things that you have to do. So when you add a T0 in front of all registers, it reflects T0. When you add T1 in front of all these registers, it reflects T1. So that is what it is. So it looks like as if it is very complicated, but it is not actually. You can actually do simple calculations as you like. So if you put a timer 0 counter control register to 00, we are configuring that as timer. You are loading timer 0 with the prescale minus of 1 depending upon your clock requirement, frequency of clock, time period of your timer counter, or frequency of timer. What is the frequency of the timer that you want? Then resetting this one is not needed. You can actually put timer counter is equal to 0 straight away. So that is something that I can directly map that one to 0. Prescale calculations, we have already seen this. So if peak clock is coming at 60 megahertz, if you want your frequency of clock, it's not timer of clock, frequency of timer. Frequency of timer to be at 1 kilohertz, then naturally prescaler plus 1 is equal to incoming is 60, outgoing I want at 1 kilohertz, 60 megahertz by 1 kilohertz will give me 60,000. This is prescaler plus 1. Prescaler is 59,999. So if I load this fellow with this value, I end up in getting 1 kilohertz at the output. With this 1 kilohertz only, the timer counter will take 50 days to overflow. Imagine what will happen if I generate much higher frequencies. Okay, so this is much lower frequencies, so that with a higher time period, it is possible for you to make the timer to run even for one full year. That is possible. This is for 1 microsecond tick. For 1 microsecond tick means frequency of timer. Frequency of timer I want is 1 megahertz. So incoming is 60. Outgoing I want 1 megahertz. So prescaler plus 1 equal to 60 megahertz by 1 megahertz, which is 60. Prescaler is equal to 60 minus of 1, that is 59. Is that clear for you all? Now let us create the time routines. This we have already seen, initializing the PLL. We'll write two delay functions. One is delay millisecond. The other one is delay microsecond. Delay milliseconds will take unsigned integer. How many number of millisecond you want as a delay? For example, if I call this function delay millisecond, 500 means this value will give me 500 millisecond delay. So that's what it is. I also wanted to have another function called delay microsecond. This fellow takes unsigned integer microsecond. In this case, the same function you can use as delay microsecond US, depending upon the number of microseconds you pass. 20 means I end up in getting 20 microseconds. So we'll write only two functions. One function for creating a 20 millisecond delay. The other one for creating a the other one is for creating millisecond delay. The other one is for creating microsecond delay. So this is what it is. I think we have discussed this in the previous class. How to initialize the PLL. First, we will set the configuration of PLL. We'll set the M select and P select so that it generates 60 megahertz. And then we use PLL control to enable this fellow. We issue the, in fact, this has to go first. So we issue the feed sequence. And then we check for the status PLOC bit to be 1. That is the 10th bit. So you can either check this with hexadecimal 400, or you can also check PLL 0 status register is logically 100 with hexadecimal 01, left shift this by 10. If this is equal to 0, keep waiting here. So this is our checking the lock bit to be 1. If that is 1, that means the PLL has achieved 60 megahertz. Then you issue PLL control list as 03. 03 means that the first two bits as 11. Enable and connect. This is connect bit, this is enable bit. So I am enabling and connecting it. Finally, I am once I connect this, I end up in getting 60 megahertz of the CP clock. From the C clock, I need to generate P clock. For that, I need to issue VLSI peripheral bus divider. If I issue PLSI bus divider as 01, that means this 60 megahertz clock is divided by a factor of 1. Then I get a P clock as same 60 megahertz. That's what we do. So once we call this init PLL, I get a peripheral clock or P clock of 60 megahertz. Because peripheral clock is the one which is supplying the clock for all the other peripherals inside. So delay microsecond, sorry, delay millisecond is the first function. So what are the functions we use? First one, we have to configure that as timer. So timer 0. Pay attention here. Timer 0, count control register, CTCR, equal to hexadecimal 00. That is the first job. What is the role of count control register? Count control register will make your timer as timer or counter. The first two bits are used for that purpose. If you set this as 00, it is configured as timer. Rest of the three cases, it is configured as counter. So let us not worry about counting now. We are configuring that as timer. So that means timer 0, there is no space here. I'm just giving for your understanding. Timer 0, count control register. This is a single word. Just pay attention here. Timer 0, count control register is equal to hexadecimal 00 means I'm configuring this as timer. So that is the first thing. Second thing, you have to load the prescalar. Timer 0, prescalar equal to 60,000 minus of 1. 60,000 minus of 1 means 59,999. Why I put 60,000 minus of 1 means just to tell you that we are end up being getting totally 60,000 in the prescalar plus 1. So this will give you some rough idea about it. So when I load a T scalar, timer 0 prescalar with 60,000 minus of 1, which means prescalar plus 1 is 60,000, which means I'm trying to divide 60 megahertz by 60,000 times. If you divide 60 megahertz by 60,000 times, I end up in getting 1 kilohertz at the output. So that is the first thing I do. Second thing, I set the prescalar. Third one, I enable the timer. This is not really necessary here. You can, if you want to reset the timer, you can put a timer 0, timer counter as 0. So that is a pretty straightforward. We simply load the value of timer 0 or timer counter with 0 value. So that is something that I don't want here. And then fourth one, you start the timer. How do you start the timer? Timer 0, timer control register equal to hexadecimal 01. The first bit of timer control register, this is the timer control register. The first two bits are of important for us. LSB is the enable bit. If you enable that fellow, the timer will start counting. If you put disable that fellow, the timer will stop counting. Recently we are not using, so I'm just using the enable bit. The enable bit is the LSB bit. So what am I doing here? So timer 0, timer control register equal to hexadecimal 01. LSB, enable bit is equal to 1. Enable equal to 1. So once you start the timer will keep counting. So eventually what am I doing? Depending upon the user's millisecond number of times, I keep waiting there. So as long as while timer 0 timer counter is less than the user given value is millisecond, I keep waiting here. Suppose if I pass 500 here, as long as timer 0 timer counter is less than 500, 0 to 499 is 500 milliseconds. The moment it becomes 500, this fellow fails. It comes out. Then immediately I stop the timer counter. Timer 0 timer control register equal to hexadecimal 00, which means I disable the enable equal to 0. Enable equal to 0 means I am disabling the timer. So these are the same thing. Whatever you are doing in 8051, the same thing I am doing it here. In 8051, we follow the reverse logic. What is the reverse logic? We never started the timer with the zero value. We started the timer with some initial value so that it overflows after the desired value. That is what we did. Suppose if I want my timer to count 1000 counts, I didn't start the timer with zero. Rather, I subtracted that 1000 from the maximum count. 65,536 minus of 1000, which gave me 64,536. With that initial value, I started the counter so that after 1000 counts, the timer will go on to overflow. That was the logic that I followed there. The logic that I followed in 8051 was, I am banking or counting on the overflow flag. In this case, because the timer will take 50 days to overflow, it is not a good choice or good practice to load the timer to that many number of counts. It is also possible for you, but it is not a good practice here because we are dealing with a 32-bit number. So most likely that you would end up in committing an error. So here, instead of loading the timer with initial value, we are loading the timer with zero, and then we control the actual frequency of the clock that is going to the timer. So depending upon our requirement, we make it either a high frequency clock or a low frequency clock, and thereby you control the timer based on the given delay requirement. So I don't start the timer with initial value, rather I start the timer with zero value. The moment it reaches the desired delay, I will come out. This is much easier than 8051 rather. So these are the six steps. So I'll repeat the steps once again. Please pay attention here to the left hand side of the slide. The first thing that I do, is I take timer 0, count control register. CTCR means count control register. I set the mode of that fellow. How do I set the mode? Timer 0, count control register, CTCR equal to hexadecimal 00. If I set 00, it means the timer is set as timer. Otherwise, it will be set as counter. Second thing, I am loading timer 0 prescalar value. Prescalar equal to 59,999. For generating 1 kilohertz to my timer. Next one, timer 0, timer counter, TC equal to 0. I reset the value of timer to 0. Then you start the timer. Timer 0, timer control register equal to hexadecimal 01. This will start the timer. And then I wait while timer 0 timer counter is less than my delay period. I keep waiting here. The moment it is reaching my delay period, I will come out. And then I stop the timer. This is a pretty straightforward delay algorithm. All of you are with me? Is that clear for you all? Okay. Now let us generate another delay function, which is microsecond delay. Concept is still the same. Only difference is we load the timer 0 prescalar with 59 instead of 59,999. The prescalar value plus 1 equal to 60 megahertz is the input. Output I wanted is 1 megahertz. So 60 megahertz by 1 megahertz is 60. So the value of prescalar that I should load is 60 minus of 1 or 59. So as usual, we configure timer 0 as timer by loading count to control register as 00. Load timer 0 prescalar with 59 or 60 minus of 1. Then timer 0 timer counter is 0. This is not required. It is directly okay. This is the most preferred way. Timer 0 timer counter, I'm just making it as 0. And then timer 0 timer control register is equal to 01. We start the timer. And then we wait until it is less than the desired delay period that you wanted. The moment it reaches, it will come out, and then you stop the timer. Is that clear for you all? Some example problems you'll take. I have not installed the software in this PC, so I just copied the code for you. So you create a timer.h. In this timer.h, you load the two functions. Delay millisecond function, delay microsecond function. Both these functions will take millisecond and microsecond as parameters. Problem 1, toggle port 0.15 with an on period of 1 second and off period of 0.5 seconds. We have not used this name. We used pin write. Pin write 15th pin with the 1. And then you call a delay. Delay millisecond, I pass 1000 as parameter. 1000 millisecond is 1 second. Second one is pin write 15th pin, I write as 0. You again call delay millisecond 1000. Now we wanted an off period of 0.5 seconds, so which means this is 500. This pin write and all GPIO related functions are available in GPIO.h. This is already we have written. This fellow has literally 5 functions. One is software delay for random delays that you wanted. One is pin write. The other one is port write. The next one is pin read. The next one is port read. These 5 functions are available in GPIO.h. In addition to that, we also have PLL, init PLL. So this you forgot to do it here. The most important thing is not available here. That is the first function that you should call. Otherwise, both these delay functions doesn't work. And init PLL is another function that you are having here. So this init PLL should be the first very important function that you should call, followed by, if you don't call PLL functions, all these timer functions won't work because we are banking on the PLL to generate 60 megahertz. Unless if you don't generate 60 megahertz, all the prescalar value, whatever you load becomes false and you will never get the delay that you wanted. So initializing PLL is very important. Okay. Problem 2. generate a square wave at 1 kilohertz. This has that function properly, initPLL. Again, the name of the functions are wrong. Pin write 15th pin with a high. 1 kilohertz means the total time period T equal to 1 millisecond. T on equal to 0.5 milliseconds or 500 microseconds. T off is another 500 microseconds. So pin write 15th pin a high. In this case, I called delay microsecond, delay US 500. So this will give me 500 microsecond delay. Then I put pin write 15th pin with a zero. I end up in getting a delay of another 500. You put this in an infinite while loop.